And now, HBO Sports presents Broad Street Bullies.
Special presentation of HBO's Sports of the 20th Century.
In any great drama, you need heroes and villains. The Flyers are both.
Here we go. Oh, now they got the hand free.
This is going to be a wild show.
And the whole thing's empty.
Talk about blood being spilled. Actual blood.
Here's Jokinen.
It's a badge of honor to be a goon.
We loved to be hated.
They were despicable.
A disgrace to hockey.
We don't have to apologize to nobody.
They were our guys.
This team unified a city.
The Stanley Cup! The Flyers win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers have won the Stanley Cup!
Born in the frozen heart of winter, and bred of Canadian grit, the game of hockey can be traced to the early 1800s. As an organized endeavor, the sport reached its golden age in the 25-year period between 1942 and 1967, when all of six teams made up the National Hockey League. The NHL enjoyed a small but passionate following, as the original six preserved the game's unique blend of grace and force, while respecting its code of aggression. But in an effort to expand Canada's national pastime, to a nationally televised American pursuit, the Lords of the Game introduced six new stateside teams in 1967. Soon, to the disgust of hockey purists, one of these fledgling franchises turned their sacred sport into a savage spectacle. And in seizing the game's holy grail, these bullies would bloody the face of the National Hockey League. But their improbable story began as a risky investment.
I learned that the league was expanding, and I felt that Philadelphia would be a great place for one of the expansion teams.
And they had these grand plans. They were going to build this new building, the Spectrum. We all laughed at them. Who are these guys? Not one of them, I think, had really ever been on a hockey rink in their entire life, a bunch of business guys from Philadelphia.
We went around to the various banks, and they were totally disinterested.
What is it, soccer? And we said, no, it's hockey. And they said, well, hockey will never go over in Philadelphia.
Another sort of fell asleep during our presentation. But the last bank we went to, Gerard Trust, fortunately the vice president, had played hockey at Harvard and loved hockey and had a lot of faith in what we were doing, and we got the loan.
After securing the $2 million expansion fee in February of 1966, the Philadelphia Flyers were officially welcomed to the NHL. Also newly minted were the St. Louis Blues, Pittsburgh Penguins, Minnesota North Stars, California Seals, and Los Angeles Kings.
Philadelphia Flyers. Philadelphia claims Vernon Kharlamov.
With their first pick in the 1967 expansion draft, the Flyers selected Bernie Parent, a young French-Canadian goaltender left unprotected by the Boston Bruins. Joining Parent on the team's inaugural roster were players also discarded by the original six. And to many of them, heading to Philadelphia was a fate far worse than rejection.
The guy come by and he says, I just heard your name on the radio. I hear you being drafted by Philadelphia. I says, what? What are you talking about? He says, yeah, I didn't know I wasn't protected by Boston. So talk about disappointment.
Starting all over again with an expansion team did not really thrill me.
First of all, I had a good look on the map and see where the heck Philadelphia was.
We're coming over the old Penrose Avenue Bridge. And on the right-hand side, there's a machine there. I asked the bus driver, I said, what's that machine doing? He says, oh, that's grinding up body parts. What the hell am I doing here?
People didn't know what hockey was. People had no idea what this sport, skates.
They had a reception at City Hall for them, and they put them in open convertibles for a ride down Broad Street. There were no more than 20 people on the parade route.
People were wondering who in the heck we were and what was going on.
He saw somebody flip the bird at them, and he heard one other guy yell from the sidewalk, you'll be in Baltimore by Christmas.
What the hell are we getting ourselves into here?
Though evidence of its role in the nation's birth was at every turn, the Philadelphia at which these young Canadians had arrived bore little resemblance to the history book version of the city. It was a hard scrabble, beer and a hoagie kind of town, heavily defined by close-knit ethnic neighborhoods and a working-class population set in its ways. Philly no longer appeared to be a place where new ideas took flight, particularly something as absurd as hockey. But there it was, in a state-of-the-art arena on South Broad Street.
Bill Sutherland scored the goal to win the first game at the Spectrum, 1-0, before 7,000 people in what Bill Putnam, the team's president, described as the worst hockey game ever played.
It took a little while for the players to get to know each other. Once we did,
we beat Montreal, we beat Boston.
And then one weekend in February, they swept Toronto and Chicago back-to-back at the Spectrum. And that's when the crowds went from four digits to five digits.
Our fans took to it at that point. It built a momentum.
Shortly thereafter, the roof blew off, so it kind of interrupted our first season.
The high winds, which halted work on the roof yesterday, made the job difficult.
55 games into their first season, severe winds sent pieces of the Spectrum roof up into the air, and their schedule along with it. Forced to play their remaining home games on the road, the Vagabond Flyers showed their resolve. With nimble skating and strong goaltending, the Keith Allen-led club finished one game below 500, enough for first place in the weak Western Division, which contained all six expansion teams. They'd again qualify for the playoffs in year two, but Philly's first forays into postseason play sent a shiver down the city's spine.
The Flyers were bludgeoned in two successive playoff years against the St. Louis Blues. Noel Picard and the Plager brothers terrorized the Flyers and broke legs intentionally and bloodied and bludgeoned the Flyers.
Claude Laforge got beat up pretty badly by Noel Picard.
He cold cocked him from behind. Broke his cheekbone, knocked out five or six teeth. And I remember Ed Snyder saying, that will never happen again.
We realized that we would have to become tougher, stronger, and bigger. And we may not be able to win a lot of games as we're growing, but we certainly didn't have to get beat up. So we decided that no team would ever intimidate us ever again. And we conducted our drafts and we conducted our philosophy in that direction.
Still battered from back-to-back beatings by the Blues, the Flyers brass attended the 1969 amateur draft with a bigger, tougher purpose in mind. Over 12 feet and nearly 400 pounds combined, fifth and sixth round picks Dave Schultz and Don Selesky fit the new Flyer mold. But the fate of the franchise was sealed earlier in the draft, when Philly took a flyer on a player thought to be damaged goods.
Bobby Clarke had diabetes, and I think most of the scouts knew that, and they were worried about his stamina.
Every team in the league passed up Bobby Clarke at least once. Several passed him up twice, and at least one passed him up three times before the Flyers took him in the second round.
Mr. Snyder called a doctor in Philadelphia who was a diabetic specialist and asked him. The doctor assured him that if I lived like a diabetic is supposed to, that I'd be able to play.
Here's a little kid that shaved with a Kleenex, and you knew he was going to be a leader right off the get-go.
Despite Clark's solid rookie season, the Flyers regressed in their third year, failing to make the playoffs with just 17 wins. Two more losing seasons followed, marked by uninspired play and little fight. After 5 years, the team was still in search of a winning season and an identity. They would find both in season six, when a player known as the Hammer came to town.
When Schultze got to the Flyers, it all changed. he became the hunter.
His mouth would twitch and his eyes would get big.
It was like a lion going into the den, and there was the red piece of meat.
Schultz is hammering Dunn. Schultz continues to flail away with the right hand. Schultz is now going to the midsection. Schultz trying to get him at long range so he can start pumping the uppercut. Now the right three, and now he's getting the better of it.
Well, Schultz's aim in his hockey life is quite obvious.
We had the baddest animal in the hockey jungle, and never even had a fight before he turned pro.
I was a goal scorer, believe it or not. Rarely fought. It wasn't until I got sent to the Eastern Hockey League by the Flyers in my first year at the end of training camp that I started fighting. I got in a fight my first game, I got in a fight my second game, and all of a sudden I was Sergeant Schultz. So I'm sure the Flyers were going, what's this Schultzy doing down there? And what was I to do except come to the Flyers and continue my ways? I became this guy that fought like crazy. If you want to try to intimidate one of the better skating players, more skilled, you better turn around because someone's coming after you. Somebody had to do it, and I did it.
He took on all of the players on all of the teams that used to beat us up and beat them up.
Here's back at you.
It was an amazing thing to watch.
Schultz has his right hand free, coming around with a roundhouse right.
When you get hit by a Dave Schultz right, he's going to break your bones.
And that can be uplifting to a team. Let's have some fun. We used to play and fight and then win, and then we'd go drink their beer.
Dave the Hammer Schultz immediately earned a reputation as the most ferocious flyer, smashing records for number of fights and time in the box. Feared throughout the league, the Hammer's goonish ways proved contagious.
It made all of our players play with a little bit bigger balls. More nerve and a little bit more aggressive.
Parisian DuPont.
We can have more policemen than anybody. Who said you only had to have one?
The scene I envision is in Blazing Saddles. Every ugly criminal in world history is applying to be part of the posse.
We're not going to let just Schultz beat the living daylights out of these guys. Now it's our turn.
Whenever the game was dull, just send out Bob Kelly, and he would liven things up.
I called him Machine Gun Kelly.
See how fast he throws?
He could throw 30 punches to your one.
He was a windmill, a whirlwind fighter.
Kelly jumped on before Butler even knew he was coming.
I always had lots of energy, so I like to expand it, and it's nothing like driving somebody's head through the boards to make you feel good.
We just happened to be better than anybody else. And we were able to beat up everybody else if we had to.
The game has been played a long time with fighting as a major element of the game. It never really was thought of as anything unusual.
There was nothing premeditated about it. It was just people in crazed search of the Stanley Cup.
But things were different for the Flyers. What the Flyers did that no other team had previously done was win through intimidation. They really made fighting a tactic. People knew right away that this was something different.
It was all part of the game plan. It was all part of the strategy. We're just going to go out and annihilate people. And by annihilating them, we're going to render them ineffective, and that's how we're going to win. And it worked.
Midway through the 72-73 season, when it became clear that nearly every Flyer game would feature a steady stream of fisticuffs and uncurbed mayhem, the club earned its fabled nickname from local sports scribe Jack Chevalier and headline writer Pete Caffone.
And there they go. And they battle
the Broad Street Bullies tallied an incredible 600 more penalty minutes than did the second most penalized team. The fist-first foursome of Dave the Hammer Schultz, Bob Hound Kelly, Don Big Bird Selesky, and Andre Moose DuPont combined for nearly 900 penalty minutes, more than the team totals for six of the league's clubs. But it wasn't all welts and bruises that marked Philly's first winning season. The physical play opened up a previously unseen flow of offense, as five Flyers scored 30 or more goals, including Cowboy Bill Flett with 43 and Rick McLeish with 50. The franchise also won its first playoff series, highlighted by Gary Dornhofer's overtime goal against Minnesota.
He comes back. Dornhofer.
A storied moment for a team still writing its history. The Flyers had altered their image from expansion pushovers to established aggressors. And by the time camp opened the following year, they had also changed their fortune. Sensing a dependable goalie was the final piece to the puzzle, General Manager Keith Allen traded for a familiar face. Talented but raw Bernie Parent had been shipped away 2 years earlier. He'd returned to the Flyer net in 73, a polished gem.
And he came back to us, the new and improved Bernie. So it was like, oh, here we go, boys. Every day in practice, piss us off. We couldn't score on him.
If you scored on him in practice, he'd fire a puck at you. I mean, he was that intense.
Without question, he was the missing link, but Bernie was different in a wonderful kind of way, fun, loving, and zany, and off the wall.
Well, he was half crazy. You know, I say half crazy, but he wasn't. He was all crazy.
He always had to have his nap in the afternoon with his German Shepherd dog. He loved to smell things. If you bought a new pair of shoes, oh my God, he was all over you. Oh, I love the smell of new leather. I mean, he'd have his nose in your shoes. I mean, what?
I'm a firm believer in life that if you're happy, happy things will happen to you.
Oh, you hit him. Oh, you're gone.
The Three Stooges kept me happy, that's for sure. I still watch them today.
Come on.
It is a beautiful thing.
The same could be said of Perrant's goaltending. Playing in all but five of Philly's games, his 1.89 goals against average and 12 shutouts led the league in 73-74. And his NHL record 47 wins stood for 33 years. Bernie Perrant was the last line of defense on a team built to do more than just brawl.
We intimidated everybody, and it wasn't just dropping the gloves.
They largely won by outworking teams. The most relentless that I've ever seen.
They weren't all bloody riots. They won a lot of games on skill.
You get guys like McLeish and Barber. They were offensive machines. Eddie Van Imp, the Watson brothers, Bladen, Barry Ashby, those guys were solid, ultra-competitive guys.
Terry Crisp, Boris Kinderchuk.
Ross Lansbury never gets enough credit for us. Like, he would score 30 goals a year and be plus 50.
Even the guys that were out there fighting were talented. Dave Schultz had 20 goals 1 year.
The goalie had no chance. I'd say, don't feel bad, because, you know, I was a sniper.
You could be the Broad Street Bullies, you could be the Joe Bellino Bullies, you could be anybody you want. Unless you have the talent, you're not going to win, period. And they had the talent.
We would not only go in and beat the shit out of their hockey team, but we beat them on the scoreboard too.
Before long, the Spectrum was sold out night after night. If anyone appreciated the fine line between talent and terror the team was skating on, it was Philadelphians. Not much had come easy to the city of late, and the Flyers' gritty brand of hockey struck a chord. They were the perfect antidote for a city longing for a lift.
If you look at the time and what happened in this country in the 70s, Philadelphia was one that was hit hard economically. Philadelphia really felt its pain. And of course, they were a city of losers. The Eagles had one championship, and that was in 60. The Phillies hadn't won a World Series coming off of 1964, where they had the dramatic collapse.
Sixers had won the title in 67, and then Wilt Chamberlain was traded. So the Sixers went downhill, and things were so bad that they liked harness racing here.
It was really a down period. This town had a complex. I get no respect. I'm from Philadelphia. Until this band of crazy nuts from Canada come in.
The fans loved us here, and the city was starved for a winner. We were in the right place at the right time.
The Flyers gave them hope.
Only God saves more than Bernie Perrin, right?
Come along with the Flyers.
It was a blue-collar team and a blue-collar city, so it was a perfect marriage.
It was all about this tough, let's grind it out every day. Men worked 2 and 3 jobs. They hustled. It was a city of hustlers. They love guys who sweat, who bleed, fighting, literally and figuratively. That team personified the city so well. The little side streets of Philadelphia. All the kids on each street had their own team. Sure enough, there would be a fight. 2 kids are going at it.
We were easy to fall in love with. There was something there for everybody.
And you know, we all looked like porn stars with the long hair, the big Fu Manchus and everything.
If we had done a reality show and it had cameras running, people would have said, no freaking way.
These guys not only were fun, they were a part of the community, they were part of the people. They were part of the people.
They all ran around the same bar outside of Philadelphia over in New Jersey called Rexy's Together.
After practice, all the players could all go there and have a beer and something to eat. And everybody started going there after the games.
There were times the wives probably hated Rexy's.
Belly up next to those guys and have a draft beer. And those guys are ready to go.
Yeah, give me another. Okay, no problem. It's on me.
We would draw 15, 20,000 people to watch us play slow pitch.
When the game's over, we'll stick around, just make sure you got some beer and hot dogs or something, and take the money that you make for charity. I think it was important for our team to become part of the community.
It really created that bond. These guys are our boys. They're family.
The 1973-74 Flyers won 50 games, 13 more than the year before. Losing just 2 of their final 20, the Broad Street Bullies captured the Western Division with 112 points. They also finished the regular season with 1,750 penalty minutes, again dwarfing the rest of the league. And their 103 fights easily eclipsed second-place Los Angeles, who could claim just 58.
Schultz is raining right hands on the Magnuson.
Balancing this deadly combination of brutality and skill required an equally balanced mind. And that's just what the Flyers had in a former amateur boxer and philosopher, an introverted student of the game, who, like the team he coached, possessed a fitting moniker of his own, Freddie the Fog Shiro.
He was a quiet guy, very cerebral, and you wouldn't think of him as a purveyor of mayhem, but he knew the guys he had on his team, and he knew what they could do, and he knew how to deploy them.
I had a team that loved to fight, so I let them fight.
Fred Shiro was an evil genius.
He had very unusual practices, where he used tennis balls to help their stick handling.
He studied videos.
He was the first to have an assistant coach on the bench.
Freddie spent so much time at home alone in the bathtub and hiding in his room and just thinking about hockey.
He said, sleeping is overrated.
We'd go to a city and he'd stay with us for a little while and then off he'd go. He'd disappear. Didn't know where he went.
And the only time he ever got in trouble was that night in Atlanta and got mugged. Somebody gave him a black eye and knocked him out in the street. Now, he missed the next game.
When he showed up, his glasses had been broken, and we really don't know what exactly happened, but we were glad to have him back.
Freddie was the mystery. He basically didn't talk to the players. The way he communicated with them is he left little notes in their locker, or he wrote things on the blackboard.
The person who has it made is only one step from being a has-been. There are no heroic tales without heroic tales. Satisfaction is death.
If you do not want to be criticized, say nothing, do nothing, and be nothing.
And oftentimes he'd put something on the board and they'd be thinking, what the hell does he mean by that?
People usually get what's coming to them, unless it has been mailed.
Sometimes it makes sense to you and sometimes they wouldn't. He was unusual, he was different, but he was awfully good.
The Fogg's infamous mugging in Atlanta came during the team's 1974 first-round playoff with the Flames. Assistant coach Mike Nikoluk stepped in for the final contest of a fight-filled Flyer sweep. Up next, a Stanley Cup semifinal pitting Broad Street versus Broadway.
It was kind of cool walking into Madison Square Garden. The circus was there. So you're walking by all the elephants and the tigers and that, getting ready to go play a hockey game. So it was fitting that we would walk by that. They thought we were part of the zoo anyways.
In their history, the Flyers had managed just one win in 19 tries at Madison Square Garden. No expansion team had ever beaten one of hockey's original six in a playoff series, and few believed the Bullies would be the first.
From the time I got here, we hated the Rangers. So that series was cruel, mean, dirty, grinding.
It was war, unbelievably even. They won all their home games. We won all our home games.
And that's when Barry Ashby had the terrible accident where he was hit in the eye by a puck.
Kelsey gets it, lobbed the shot, and hit Barry Ashby. The Dornhofer trying to get at Clarke, and there they go.
And it was bloody and bitter.
Watch out, Rick. Oh, they got him good.
And it was Schultze that swayed it in our favor.
Early in Game 7, there was a collision between Schultz and Dale Rolfe.
Davey just hammered him.
Rolfe and Dave Schultz, the main event here. Schultz lands two or three punches. Rolfe tried to pin him against the glass. They're all alone as the linesman have everybody else separated.
Oh, my God almighty. Hit him a number of times, and then he grabbed his hair.
Now Schultz has a grip on Rolfe's hair. Schultz throwing punches, and Dale Rolfe getting the worst of this.
He was pummeling them, and not one New York Ranger came to his defense. Now, this would have never happened with a Flyer team. If somebody was getting beat up, watch out.
That kind of showed us that, you know, wait a minute, these guys aren't going to stick together or back one another up. I don't think there was a guy on the team that didn't really believe that we were going to beat them. Once we did that, we thought, oh my God, we're in the Stanley Cup Finals.
The Flyers were huge underdogs going into this series against Boston.
Well, we didn't have home ice and we hadn't won there in 7 years.
I think the odds were 50-1 against us. I mean, let's face it, they had
Bobby Orr, Phil Esposito, Ken Hodge, Wayne Cashman, and the list goes on and on.
It's not gonna be easy, but we'll just have to do our best. Thanks for coming out. I really appreciate it.
Embracing their underdog status, the city was ready for the mighty Bruins.
Go Flyers, go!
Go Flyers!
What are the Flyers going to do to the Bruins in this final series?
They're going to twist them like they twist these pretzels.
Despite Philly's optimism, the heavily favored Bruins took the series opener 3-2 on a late goal by superstar Bobby Orr. In Game 2, Boston led 2-1 with under a minute to play, when Philly got an unexpected boost from a moose.
It's Dornhofer who's come on. Centering pass. Good luck. He scores! Good pass. Scores. The ball set up.
Moose did his moose shuffle dance. So then the game went into overtime.
We're 10 minutes into overtime, and a fan behind us, a Boston Bruin fan, yells to Fred Chiarel, put Schultz out there so we can score. I hadn't seen the ice for 20 minutes. He said, Clarke, Flett, and Schultz.
Schultz behind the net, centers, Flett, tries to Clarke, shot, oh, rebound, score! Tommy Clarke scores! Scores the game winner at 12 minutes and 1 second of sunset.
Turns out to be the biggest goal of my career. But if you don't win the series, it's just another goal.
Lifted by Game 2's stolen victory, Clarke and company returned home. Before a rocking Spectrum crowd, won games 3 and 4 to take a 3-1 series lead. The gloves were back off for game 5 in Boston, but it wasn't enough to hold off a 5-1 Bruin onslaught. Sensing their opponent had regained its home swagger, the Flyers faced a do-or-die game 6 in Philadelphia.
Now we go back to Philadelphia, and they're ahead 3-2. If we won that game, there's no way ever would they ever beat us in the 7th game in Boston.
We knew if we had to go back to Boston for game 7, we were toast.
Fortunately for the Flyers, Lady Luck was on their side. Singer Kate Smith, a radio star of the 30s and 40s, made an unlikely charm for this band of thugs. But for 5 years, Smith's voice provided a winning soundtrack to the flourishing love affair between Philly and its Flyers.
I had noticed that because of the Vietnam War and a lot of apathy in America and anti-American spirit, that at hockey games, people were talking and walking around during the national anthem, and it bothered me. And I came across this recording of Kate Smith that she made on Armistice Day, November 11th of 1938. And I thought, wow, what a great song. So one night, I told the sound booth, I said, I've got a tape for you of God Bless America. We're going to play this tonight instead of the national anthem. And he said, are you kidding? I said, no, we're going to play this. God bless America. And little by little, they started to get into the song, and we wound up beating Toronto 6-3 that game. So I then got it into my head that maybe we should use this again, but only when we need it.
Over 5 seasons, the Flyers were an astounding 35-3-1 when Smith's recording of God Bless America preceded a game. Smith herself was making just her second live appearance as the Flyers and Bruins faced off for Game 6.
God bless America.
I felt the roof would come down. It was so powerful. It wasn't just the singing, it was that charisma she carried with her. I get the goosebumps just talking about it.
God bless America.
She was the great lady of Philadelphia. Belting it out. And we loved her. She was ours.
There was that feeling right afterwards. There's no way the Flyers are going to lose. No way.
And I remember Kate Smith, and I says, not tonight, sweetheart. What I really wanted to say was, not tonight, fat lady, not tonight.
After Kate Smith blessed America and the Flyers, a first period goal by winger Rick McLeish put Philly up 1-0. It was the only goal the Flyers would score that day. Fortunately, they had more than a lucky song to hold off the Bruins.
He shut us down the whole stinking game. Bernie was stupendous.
They go, oh man, we're gonna win this thing. They're not gonna score on Bernie.
Coming down to the end and looking at that clock and realizing, wait a minute, we're gonna win the cup. We are gonna win the cup.
Gene Hart's enraptured victory call spoke to the improbability of the moment. In just their 7th season, the Philadelphia Flyers captured hockey's holy grail. Among the bullies engraved into Lord Stanley's cup was defenseman Barry Ashby, whose injury against the Rangers proved to be career-ending. The following day, Ashby and his mates were swept away by a wave of brotherly love.
Who could have thought that a hockey team would draw over 2 million people to a parade?
It was unreal. You looked up at just a wall of people. All through Broad Street, it was so hard to get through. The fans were so excited. It was a holiday.
It
was mind-boggling. I mean, it was scary, really, because we were sitting on top of cars, and people right there grabbing your arms.
The sleeve from the coat that I had on was ripped right off. It was gone.
The Flyers set the standard for people hanging out windows, people hanging on the light posts, and people hanging out of trees.
There were young, old, black, white, boy, oh boy, everywhere you looked, there were happy faces.
The celebration of the Flyers' championship was the largest public gathering the city had ever seen.
We were loved in Philadelphia, and we were equally as hated in every other city.
The Flyers hung an effigy.
People hated us.
Carrier, he is not too popular here in Buffalo.
And I remember going on the road, and you see big headlines in papers. Keep your wives and children inside. The Flyers are in town.
Hide the women and children. Here come the animals.
I had a friend tell me one time he wanted to drain his toilet and dry the enamel and paint a Flyer logo in the bowl.
We had police escorts here and there. Windows in our bus being busted.
They'd chase us for 4 or 5 blocks, running from one traffic light to the next. And at each one, every time they caught up with the bus, they'd give us the old signal, here.
You get the usual death threats, and it was good. I love that. They're supposed to hate you, right? If you don't do anything for them to dislike you, then you're not much of an opponent.
In that case, Bobby Clarke may have been the league's top adversary. No player better fit the team's polarizing persona than number 16, a ruthless, toothless rink rat whose on-ice antics were semi-legal, but fully effective.
I could see him with the toothless smile. It was a real smile that connoted happiness and victory.
Congratulations on a super season.
Thank you very much.
Bobby Clarke. Two words, ferocious and relentless.
Cut and bleeding, getting stitches between periods and coming right back and feeding somebody right in front of the slot.
An ultimate warrior. He would leave it all out there, every minute of every game.
His will bordered on the supernatural. From a very young age, I was taught that you work when you play. I didn't know any other ways.
And if you couldn't be inspired, there's something wrong with you.
Bobby Clarke was one of the most inspirational players ever. He's also one of the filthiest players ever.
We hated his guts.
He would chop you on the ankles. He would chop you on the hands.
He unquestionably took liberties because he knew he'd be protected.
If anybody looked at him cockeyed, Kelly or Schultz or Selesky or Van Imp or somebody would beat the hell out of him.
Maneri really wanted Clarke, but his teammates protected him in a hurry.
The Flyers had a rookie named Steve Short, and he took a run at Clarke the first day of training camp, and he went to the hospital every day for a week after that.
You didn't miss with the boss. You don't miss with the Don, and Bobby was the Don of the Flyers.
An 8-time All-Star and 3-time league MVP, the cold-blooded capo of the Flyer family was joined in the club's title defense by a player naturally nicknamed the Rifle. Reggie Leach had been languishing in the league before being placed alongside Bobby Clarke and future Hall of Famer Bill Barber. Forming one of the most prolific trios in league history, the LCB line combined for over 100 goals in the 74-75 season, as the Flyers won a league-best 51 games. After a first-round playoff bye and a second-round sweep of Toronto, the Flyers' run at another title began to take a curious turn.
Now the Flyers and Islanders come together for the semifinals. The Flyers win the first three. And darn if the Islanders don't come back and win the next three. And the night that the Islanders tied the series, Rexy's burned down. Holy smokes, is this an omen?
When it burnt down, everybody wore black armbands out on the practice rink because our bar burnt down.
The Flyers extinguished the Islanders in Game 7 to set up a Stanley Cup final with the Buffalo Sabres. It was the first time two expansion teams would battle for the Cup. Philadelphia took games 1 and 2 at the Spectrum. But as the series shifted to Buffalo, the Flyers began to play in a fog, literally.
They didn't have air conditioning in the auditorium in Buffalo.
It was 75 degrees.
And fog all over the ice.
We couldn't see anything on the ice.
It was just another chapter. It was the Flyers, what do you expect?
There was a bat, too. There was a face-off in the Buffalo end. This bat comes right down out of the ceiling.
So Jimmy Lorenz takes a stick and knocks the bat out of the air and clunks him.
Killed the bat. Poor Jimmy, he got hate mail from animal lovers for years. The next bit of drama was nobody was going to pick it up.
Rick and McLeish takes his glove off and picks the goddamn thing up. I says, Hawk, don't pick the damn thing up. You might get rabies. And Ricky says to me, what are rabies?
Befuddled by the bat and dazed from the haze, the Flyers dropped games 3 and 4 in Buffalo. But when the series returned to Philadelphia, so did the Flyers' focus. Bernie Parent stopped all but one shot in a lopsided Game 5 victory. And two nights later, posted yet another cup-clinching shutout. His heroics were to be expected. But the winning score came from an unlikely source.
Timed it up by Korab. Kelly has it. Oh, Bernie scores! Bob Kelly for Kent to face the kick. It's all over! The Flyers have won the second in a row! The Flyers have won their second consecutive Stanley Cup!
The Broad Street Bullies, back-to-back champs. Proof they were no fluke. And while both titles galvanized the entire Delaware Valley, the club's second crown became a family affair.
Mr. Snyder had the vision to bring the fathers in. We're holding the cup, you know, and he's got his cigarette going. He says, you want a cigarette? I said, yeah, sure, I'll have one, you know. He was thrilled to death.
It was just a special time for my father and all the fathers that were there. And they got treated so royally.
It's 95 degrees out. Dad shows up, woolen socks on. He had cow shit all over his boots because he was a butcher. Oh my God. It was kind of embarrassing, but that's the way Dad was. They enjoyed the celebrations with us, and they enjoyed drinking the beer just as much as we did.
Baby, how long will you keep me in the penalty box? Baby, I'm wrong, but it's lonely in the penalty box.
Some guy came to me and said, you want to do a record? I said, I can't sing, which I can't.
Sometimes it can be rough.
He wasn't exactly the Beatles or Bruce Springsteen, I'm going to tell you that.
I never get enough.
Well, that was the worst record I've ever heard. That was, like, ridiculous. But it was pretty funny when you think about it. I'd like to hear that. I haven't heard it for over 30 years.
You got me bumping and shoving, hungry for loving, and then you're going outside on me.
It was played every 15 minutes. I mean, it was on number one, just ahead of Elton John's Freedom Song.
In the penalty box.
He lived in the penalty box. I'm surprised they didn't put a cot down there. They didn't have dinner served for him. He lived in the penalty box.
Did I get caught up in it? No question.
And Magnuson, oh, a tremendous right. Magnuson is getting pummeled. He's getting beaten to a pulp.
Once you develop a reputation, it becomes expected. I mean, when I'm sitting in the Spectrum and fans are yelling, we want Schultz, they weren't looking for a goal.
Five fighting for Schultz, 10 and a misconduct, and a game misconduct.
The Hammer's pugnaciousness may have found parody in song, but his behavior was no laughing matter. During the Flyers' second Stanley Cup season, Schultz racked up 472 penalty minutes, nearly 8 full games, to set a record that remains unchallenged over 3 decades later. Dave Schultz was king in an era when violence and circus-like chaos began to reign over the NHL.
Once our teams got on the map, they went, holy shit, we better try to keep up with these guys.
Merrill Thompson going after Kiprechuk.
Every team would go out and try to find a couple of guys who would stand up for their team against the Flyers. So this arms race began.
Weren't rules against bench clearing, third man in, instigator, all those rules did not exist yet. So it was a very much of a free-for-all type of hockey.
Now they got the hand free. Now they got it free. Cournoyer is knocked there by Harris. Cournoyer is knocked to the ice by Harris.
There weren't enough cops for the lawlessness on the ice at that stage.
This is becoming a ridiculous situation.
We were just ultimate fighters without the cage around us.
I felt that the game was being desecrated.
And now a fan gets involved and Ted Harris decked a fan. The fans should stay away and let the players settle their own squabble. When are they going to wake up and realize it? That guy should be gone.
It wasn't really hockey anymore.
This was a common lament directed at the Broad Street Bullies, whose conduct on the way to capturing their two Stanley Cups gave the league a black eye. They were the ugly villains one of its darkest chapters.
Is going to go to the penalty box.
They turned hockey into roller derby, world wrestling, a bar fight. They're in the penalty box for me as a fan forever because of the way they played those 2 years.
Because they brawled their way to the cup in common parlance. To the purists, they represented everything evil about the game. They were a disgrace.
The league never expected to see that kind of thing happen. It did not sit very well with the hierarchy. Certainly Mr. Campbell was very upset with their style of play.
Clarence Campbell had presided over the NHL since 1946, and in guiding the league through the expansion era, tripled its size and stature. But what was he to do about his punch-happy champions? To Campbell, the Flyers were both a burden and a blessing.
I don't think he ever penalized the Flyers in any way that anybody thought was outrageous. Television audiences liked them. They were filling buildings.
You go to L.A., you go to Oakland, they might have 8,000, 9,000 people in the Flyers show up. The building is sold out.
They'd be sold out for weeks. There'd be lines around the block to get in to see us.
They were big box office. The NHL smelled money with the Flyers.
If they never won a championship, they wouldn't care. They would have just been angry at him. But that's what really pissed off the NHL office. Not only did they beat people up, they won a stinking Stanley Cup. Not one, but two.
You think when Clarence Campbell, Mr. Clarence Campbell, had to hand that Stanley Cup to us, he was happy?
Mr. Campbell certainly would not have been very happy about handing over the Stanley Cup to the Philadelphia Flyers in those 2 years. Absolutely not.
I'm sure if he could, he would have handed it with one hand and used the other hand to hold his nose.
They were on our side big time in one game. They wanted us to win this game badly.
That game was held January 11th, 1976. As the nation prepared to celebrate its bicentennial, the two-time Stanley Cup champs played host to the powerful Soviet Red Army Club. The Cold War had been building between Eastern and Western powers for 30 years, a conflict expressed through military and economic competition. The battle for supremacy on the world stage also extended to athletics. Widely considered the world's elite, the Red Army Club was unbeaten against three of the NHL's premier teams during a two-week North American tour. In the tension-filled finale, the Outlaw Flyers were suddenly asked to defend the honor of the National Hockey League.
We were hated prior to that, but all of Canada suddenly was rooting for us.
All of a sudden, we had Clarence Campbell in our locker room prior to the game. He listened, boys, our reputation is riding. You've got to win this game.
We weren't too crazy that they were in our locker room, being honest. We felt like saying, get out. We know what we got to do.
Some of the guys that I'd played against in 72 and hated were still on the team then, and I still hated them. So for me, it was another chance to get after them.
If we win, I'm going to be sky high, and if we lose, I think it'll be worse than dying.
Flyers coach Fred Shiro had spent years studying the Soviet system and knew exactly how to counterattack the enemy. Rather than chasing the puck carrier, the Fog instructed his players to throw up their own iron curtain at center ice.
They can't seem to figure this out at all.
And once they had stifled the Russians, it was time to dismantle them.
The Russians have heard about us. They expect an aggressive game. Well, let's not send them home disappointed. Let's give it to them.
Oh, what a check! With the thing going high, players getting physical now. Oh, Toronto, the city built it by Bill Barber.
You had fun in the league here, but you didn't play us.
They went barreling into the corner. They're playing Portland.
They wanted to experience playing in the Spectrum, and so we fulfilled their wishes for them.
Ed Van Impe came out of the penalty box all the way across the ice and nailed Valerie Kharlamov.
Kharlamov again! Kharlamov is really belted by Van Impe.
He ran into my elbow with his chin. And down he went.
The Soviets are all standing up. They want a penalty.
He's laying on the ice. He's face down, and there's no penalty. And that was it. Konstantin Loktyev just got up and he said, well, guys, we're going home. That's it. We're not going to finish this game.
The Russian coach called his team off the ice.
They are leaving the ice.
They're going to go.
The Soviets are leaving. They're going home.
You quit. You walk off.
It took just a little more than half the first period for the Russians to retreat.
We don't need this kind of hockey. This is anti-hockey.
Hey, we're not going to put up with this. This is not hockey. This is warfare. I remember running for the press box down there, and Ed Snyder went up to their coach and through an interpreter, he said to him,
tell them they're not going to get paid.
You want to leave? Go ahead. You're not getting any money. And 15 minutes later, the Russian team appeared back on the ice.
So the communists were a little bit more capitalistic than people thought.
Maybe in their minds, they thought if they came back, we'd be more careful or we wouldn't play Flyer hockey. But they were sadly mistaken.
Just 17 seconds after returning to the ice, the Soviets were greeted by the rifle. The Broad Street Bullies, pride of the hockey-free world, outshot the Red Army Club 49-13 on the way to a 4-1 victory.
I don't drink vodka, but I did that night.
There was the cartoon in the Pravda in the Russian paper of the Flyers with huge clubs, how we beat their poor little Russian players. We loved it. We just loved it. We think we saved America, we saved Canada, we saved the hockey world, and all from the most unlikeliest bunch of guys you've ever met in your life.
This was the size of the rule book, and it's probably 80, 85 pages in length. I can't give Philadelphia Flyers the total credit for making this book be this thick versus what it used to be, but I can say this and guarantee it, they definitely played a part in some of it.
By the late 1970s, the NHL rulebook was amended with language designed to clean up the game. The new laws surely robbed the Flyers of some punch, but then so did the wear and tear of playing Flyer hockey. Still, no rule or injury could stop the Bullies from battling their way to a third straight Stanley Cup final in 1976. Waiting for them were the Montreal Canadiens, original six royalty, still holding claim to a more dignified game.
The Canadiens were the ones that were going to heaven, and the Flyers were the ones that were going to hell.
They were on a mission. They had to retake the Holy Grail from the heathens. There was no question that they had that kind of pressure on them.
Every decent hockey fan wanted these guys to be taught a lesson. And it took the Montreal Canadiens, Larry Robinson in particular, to take these guys to the woodshed.
If you're going to school and this big bully keeps coming up and bothering you, how do you counteract that? You fight fire with fire. So we stood up to them.
As they dispatched these thugs, and it was a beautiful thing.
Playing without injured stars Bernie Parent and Rick McLeish, Flyers were beaten in four straight. The series was closer than the sweep would suggest, as three games were decided by just a goal. Reggie Leach became the first non-goaltender on a losing team to be named playoff MVP. The Rifles' 19 postseason goals is a record that stands to this day. But the final bell had rung on the Flyers. The Canadians would go on to win four straight Stanley Cups, re-establishing order in the NHL. As purists rejoiced in Philly's demise, 17,007 strong stood in appreciation of their beloved Bullies. The team hadn't yet left the ice before its lasting impact had been felt.
Our legacy now is exactly what it was then. Loved in one part of the world and hated everywhere else. And there isn't an apologetic bone in my body or anybody else's body on our team.
I don't think we care. They can say whatever they want.
We don't have to apologize to nobody.
I wouldn't change the way we played for anything, and I don't really care what people think. I mean, I'm proud of our history. I'm proud of what we accomplished.
They weren't inside that black and orange uniform. And when you put that on, you didn't let that sweater touch the floor.
In the late 1960s, a group of small-town Canucks cursed their misfortune as they were exiled to a hopeless Yankee city. Four decades and two championships later, they not only remain Philly's favored sons, but more than a dozen still call Broad Street home. The Bullies may have bent a rule or two on their climb to the top, but the one that the team and its city have abided by is the chalky edict Fred Shiro declared en route to their first cup. Win today, and we walk together forever.
The amazing thing is, it's been a lot of years since we won that last cup. The people in the area still grasp us and still hold us.
Hey, they're the Bullies. And they literally walk on water. That team was passed down from generation to generation in Philadelphia. My niece knows about Bob Clarke and the Watson brothers, and she's 10. They're indelible in people's minds.
Sometimes you look back and say, was it real? As a team, as a city, there's a lot to be grateful for. The memories will stay with us forever.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports.